Welcome back to Bible study. Continuing on, in Leviticus chapter 3 today. We're moving right along through the book of the law. Been a couple of weeks since we did one of these. I had surgery last week and I was kind of incapacitated, so I apologize for that. But like I say, months from now, you'll never know it. You look back over the YouTube and you'll never know how much space there was in between each one of those. Just a reminder, as we continue through this, I've read this before. I wrote these words down when I first started studying and taking notes about the book of Leviticus, because it's very important to keep this in mind. It's very important for me to keep reminding myself of this fact, and therefore I considered it very important to keep reminding those who care to listen to my opinion of these facts. And just a reminder, I've read it, like I said, I will read it again and again and again as we go through this. But we need to keep in mind, we need to bear in mind, and always remember and never forget, as we work our way through the book of Leviticus, it is vital that we remember these simple facts. God did not change. God did not die. God did not run away. God did not retire and move to another quadrant. God did not give up and quit being God. He did not say, well, I've just had a belly full of this and I want to quit. He did not do that. God is not asleep. There's not things going on in the world that he's not aware of. He don't doze, he don't sleep, he don't slumber, the Bible says. And God is not busy doing other stuff and just not paying attention. He's not concentrating on this life somewhere a million light years away on this planet, where he's trying to engage with some life forms that he created and put there, and he's forgot about what's going on planet Earth where he placed his people originally. That's not what's happened. None of these things have happened. None of these things. In 2016, which is the year we're coming close to an end, fast to an end of, but in 2016, we serve the exact same eternal being that instructed Moses to write these words down that we are going and we're working our way through in approximately 1450 to 1470 BC. 3,500 years ago in the timeline, if anybody cares to keep up. 3,500 years ago, the same God, the same Yahweh, told Moses to write this stuff down that we serve today. And the fact that we serve him today in this morally bankrupt society that we live in does not make him any different. It doesn't make him changed whatsoever. God is not a different God because the people of earth have socially advanced. God is not a different God because the people of earth have adopted a different set of social values, or a different political party, or a different set of ideological talking points. None of that affects God. None of that changes him. God don't have opinions. He don't waver from day to day. He's not affected by social change. You're not ever going to be able to go to God and say, look, I know this is how you feel about this, but if you would just consider this particular circumstance right here, you might change your mind. Not going to happen. Not going to happen. It don't matter how socially and politically advanced we consider ourselves to be. It don't matter how intellectual we consider ourselves to have become. It don't matter how much we think we as a society have evolved from knuckle-dragging monkeys of Neanderthal man. It does not matter. It changes him not. His word is eternal. See, before these words were ever written down, they were already established eternally. The Bible is not the manifestation of God looking around one day and he said, you know what, I got some pretty good ideas that I've come up with lately, and I think I need to write them down so they can become a part of the historical record. That's not what the Word of God is. The Word of God is eternal. It's from eternal to eternal. It always has been. This is not a recent idea. This is not a decision that God made based on a set of social circumstances or political circumstances or anything else that happened on the face of the earth. He said, hey, you know what? My ideas are kind of getting away from me. I need to make some kind of historical account. I need to write this down before people try to go against me. That's not how this happened. This is not some knee-jerk reaction. This is not some idea that he had a few days ago. The Word of God is from eternal to just like He is. Holy, 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 the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. He is His Word. He is His Word. He is His Word forever. So these things don't change. These things don't change, no matter how we don't like to talk about things that He put into words, no matter how we don't like to consider ourselves to have to be a part of that, we are. There's no escape from it. There is no escaping from the encapsulation that we are in the Word of God. We can't come outside of it. We can think outside of it. We can rebel against it. We can refuse to accept it. But the eternal Word of God that does not change is very, very clear about what happens to those who rebel and refuse to accept and reject His Word. And it's for an eternity. It's for forever. It is an eternal decision that you make. It's not like pulling up to a stop sign and thinking, do I go right or do I go left? Which way do I think is going to have the least amount of traffic? It's not that kind of decision. It is the most important decision anyone ever makes concerning anything. I don't care what it is. There is nothing on this earth. There is nothing on this earth that can even come close to encapsulating the importance wrapped up in a decision like your eternal acceptance or rejection of the Word of God. All of it. You can't say, I like this part, but I don't like the rest. It don't happen that way. It is what it is. You either accept it or you don't. The most important decision we'll ever make, because just like I just stated, none of His opinions, none of His ideas, none of His commandments, none of His laws, none of His rules of order, nothing about God has ever or will ever change. Ever. Nothing will ever change. It has not and it will not ever. So we accept it or we don't. But it's vital for us to understand, because we've considered ourselves to become advanced to the point that we're just barely connected to the Bible. The church, the so-called church, the so-called body of Christ that exists in the world, but especially in America today, has gotten itself to the place where it is so complacent with the Word of God. And we've been taught and directed and led in directions that are so far away from, and they literally are diametrically opposed to the standards in the Bible, that we don't realize it. And when somebody raises a point of truth, when somebody raises a point of scriptural truth, people look at you like you're crazy because they've never heard it before. They don't know what you're talking about. They've never heard about what you're saying before. I mean, they thought Jesus just loved everybody and accepted everybody, and He was all about, you know, peace and love and handing out flowers and putting flowers in the rifles of barrels. And I mean, Jesus was the original commie, blah, blah, on and on and on. He was the original, you know, all of these things. He was the original Libby. He was, you know, all of these things that are so not Him. The Jesus that most people worship, and I say this a lot, and sometimes it sounds flippant, and sometimes it sounds overly grave, depending on the point that I'm trying to make. But the fact of the matter is, And it's a sad, sad fact. But the fact, the absolute fact of the matter is that the Jesus that most people worship does not exist. It is a false God that people have created in their own minds, and they've wrapped the name of Jesus around it because the name Jesus gives them internal warm and fuzzies. But the absolute existence of that Jesus that they describe, when you start listening to him, does not exist. He is non-existent. And he is so diametrically opposed to the one that does actually scripturally exist that when you start pointing out the differences, they think you're some kind of insane. How can you say that about Jesus? How can you say those words? I've had people say that to me before. How can you talk about Jesus the way you do? Because when I talk about the Jesus that you react that way to, I might as well be talking about Moloch or Baal or Beor. I might as well be talking about any of those false gods. The goddess Diana, Neptune, Jupiter, Mars, any of those. I might as well be talking about any of those because they are as non-existent as the Jesus you serve is. We are close, people. I cannot overemphasize the fact that we are woefully unaware of what's going on in the world around us. Every single thing in the universe is screaming. Jesus is on his way, and no one, literally no one, is paying attention. No one is listening. No one is looking for it to happen. Because we are so caught up in what's going on in the world and in America and in the Kardashians' life and in the Real Housewives of Atlanta and in all these Survivor shows. We're caught up in the goings on of stupid daily life. The universe is screaming in our ears that Jesus is on his way, and nobody's paying attention. Why do you think the Bible promises you a crown? A crown is something that you earned after an achievement, after a lot of work. A crown is something that you earn. And I'm not talking about a royalty crown. I'm talking about a crown, a prize. A prize that you earn. It's a crown that you earn for doing something vastly, very, very important and doing it better than everybody else. That's why you get rewarded crowns. Why do you think that there is a crown involved just in the simple fact that people who are looking for Jesus to return get a crown for it? Because it's not because Jesus wants to hand out billions and billions and billions of crowns, because that's not going to happen. Listen, folks, when Jesus said that a few people will find the way, the road, the way is narrow and it's straight. And that don't mean straight like a straight line. It means the way is narrow and it's bumpy and it's full of obstacles and you're going to get bruised. You're going to stump your toe. You're going to fall. You're going to cut your arm. You're going to do face plants. The way is straight and few there be that find it. You think he was joking about that? Do you think he was kidding when he said, do you think he was misinformed when he said that a very, very few people are going to find their way? So few, in fact, that he promised us the reward of a crown of achievement just for loving his appearing, just for looking around and waiting and watching for him to come. It's not because he's going to be handing out billions of crowns. It's because there's going to be a very few people, and he's going to be extremely proud of those few who were able to make it through all the muck and the garbage and the crap that goes on in our everyday lives, that we are so, all the shiny stuff that we're so drawn to and wrapped up in. There's going to be so few people who can look through all that muck and mire and hang on to the truth, to the scriptural, biblical truth of what's going on. And everything in this universe, from the animals to the atmosphere itself, everything in this, in the world we live in, is screaming, primal screams, Jesus is coming, and he's coming soon. And nobody is listening. Nobody. He was not kidding when he said that his remnant was small. He was not joking when he said there'd be few that will find it. Very few. It's not a joke. And he hadn't changed. He didn't misunderstand what was going on. It's not the fact that he couldn't look into the future and see the real future, that he was misinformed, that he didn't understand what a wonderful group of people were going to be alive on the face of the earth in 2016. That's not the problem. That is not the mistake that he made. He didn't make any mistakes. He spoke the truth. He laid the truth out. He wrote the truth down. Now it's up to you and me, brethren, to accept it or reject it. And it's up to you and I to accept or reject every single word of it, whether we like it or not. Because in the end, at the end of the day, after all is said and done, you're going to be rewarded based on how the gospel changed you. You're not going to receive rewards based on how you were able to manipulate your way through the avalanche of Scripture and find the stuff that really, really, really matters, because it's not a buffet. You're not going to be rewarded based on your ability to scan the outside or to get through the crowd and not be noticed. You're going to receive rewards based on how the gospel changed you, not how you change the gospel. So it's simple. We either figure out a way to use the words that are in the Bible to our personal advantage, prosperity gospel, hyper faith, name it, claim it, whatever you want to call it, or you're going to choose to allow the gospel to change you and shape you and mold you into the image of Christ, which is exactly what it's intended to do. And that image is not some retro, you know, Reverend Ike or whatever. It's not how to become big and have a big talk and have a big ministry and drive a big car and live in a big house and show the world how prosperous it is to be a preacher. That is not what the gospel does. That's not how the gospel changed. The gospel is not designed to change poor people into rich people. That is not the purpose and the intent of the gospel of Jesus. The gospel of Jesus is intended to break us down, to show us what sinners we are, to show us every day that we need a Savior. We can't make it without a Savior, and there is no hope without a Savior. Not for us to grab that Savior by the coattails and say, look at me, I'm a Jesus boy. Send me money and I'll teach you how to be a Jesus boy too. That's not what it is. God hadn't changed. He's not different. He didn't retire. He didn't die. He didn't go away. He's not asleep. And he is paying attention. Close attention. He's paying attention to how you treat his word, how you accept his word, what you do with his word, how you react to his word, and how you allow his word to make you a better person, not the other way around. In chapter 1 of Leviticus, we talked about the whole or the burnt offering. Everything had to be burnt up. Everything was wholly given. It was designed to make God favorable, to give yourself humbly to God. A perfect bull or sheep or goat or birds, called pigeons or doves, and they burned up everything. We'll get more into all those other things later on. Chapter 2, we covered the meat or the grain offering. It's the only offering that's called meat that does not have anything to do with flesh of an animal. It's a grain, a barley, an oat. It's a flour offering. And it's to thank God and also to make him favorable to the offerer. through that sweet smell, to give our goods and our work to God. It's a cake or a bread with no salt or yeast or honey, and I mean with salt, but no yeast or honey, and they burned some of it, and the priest ate some. It was not a whole or burnt offering. Chapter 3, we're going to talk about peace offerings. Peace is a funny word, because it's not the peace offering like we like to think of the word peace. We like to think of the word peace in that, like peace in time of war, or peace with, like, you've been fighting with your neighbor, you've been fighting with your wife or husband, or you've been fighting with whatever, and at the end of that, there's peace. There's peace, but it's that kind of peace, but it's not that kind of peace at all, because the word peace in the peace offering, we're going to read some scriptures where Jesus said that he leaves his peace with us. The word peace is not the kind of peace where everything around us is calm and tranquil, and, you know, like these phony fake Facebook posts where people put on there with just puppies and kittens and flowers, a field of flowers and a sunshiny day, and usually got some teenage girl standing there like this, and it's just everything's just A-OK. Not that kind of peace. It's not that kind of peace. It's a peace in the storm, not peace from the storm. We are not promised peaceful, tranquil lifestyles where nothing ever happens and our feathers are never ruffled. We're not promised that at all. But if you listen to the preachers and the indoctrinators of today, then you get that sense of that's what the gospel is all about. I mean, we're here to make your life so fantastic. God wants to give you so much money and so much new things and so many toys and such great places to live and give you the best addresses and give you the best parking spaces and give you the best vehicles to ride around in and give you the best houses to live in with hot and cold running maids and butlers and addressmen and chauffeurs and whatever it is that we consider there's no way your life cannot be so great that it has to be peaceful. Peace is just an anomaly that comes along with that thing, but that's not the peace of the gospel. That's not the peace that was involved in these peace offerings. That's not the peace that we're looking for. That's not the peace that Jesus promised us in his peace. We'll find out more about that. So let's jump right in to Leviticus chapter 3. And you'll find as we go through Leviticus chapter 3 again, I've mentioned this before, when we dig into a new chapter and start into a new thing, there's going to be a whole lot to talk about in the beginning, and most of the chapter we'll just read through, because it's just a re-enunciation of things that we've already talked about, or like I said before also, when things are in the book of Leviticus, a lot of times they're written 3 and 4 times in a row. We're going to find that out in chapter 3. We're going to see a perfect example of that, because it's going to go through and describe a certain sacrifice, and then it's going to go through and use practically the same words over and over again to describe the same exactual technique with the different animals. So we'll cover these things. It's 17 verses in chapter 3, but we should cover them pretty quick, because the bulk of what you have to talk about in a Bible study occurs in the first few verses, and maybe in the last one we'll talk about. But for the most part, it's just reading through. The people at church last night were extremely happy about that, because they're used to me going through and breaking down every word and every verse, and sometimes they think that's a little much, I believe. But anyway, let's jump right in, Leviticus chapter 3, verse 1. And if the oblation, if his oblation is another word for gift or sacrifice. If his oblation be a sacrifice of peace offering, if he offer it of the herd, now that word herd refers to cattle. Later on we're going to read where if it comes from the flock is describing sheep and goats. But the word herd is used speaking of cattle, bulls. If the offer be of the herd, whether it be a male or female, here's another one that we've run up on for the first time. It can be either a male or a female. Up to this point, it is required to be a male. And as we go through the other sacrifices, some of them will be required to be male also. There's a reason for that. There is nothing in the Bible for no reason at all. There's not a word in the Bible where when the Holy Spirit was directing men to write these things down. There's not a single word in the Word of God where the Holy Spirit come upon a place and he said, you know, I just need to fill some space. Just write this stuff down. It really is insignificant. That don't happen in the Bible, in the Word of God. So there's a reason it can be male or female, or if it has to be a male. If he offered of the herd, whether it be male or female, he shall offer it without blemish before the Lord. Again, remember what before the Lord means, at the tabernacle, before God. You do everything you do just like Jesus is watching you all the time, because guess what, brothers and sisters, he is. He's there with you. He never goes away. Where you go, he is forced to go with you. If you go in a place that maybe not be made all that great or all that desirable for him to be in, guess what? He has to go in there. You had the form of the Holy Spirit. If the Holy Spirit is living within your body, if you are a saved, born again child of God and the Holy Spirit lives in your body, where you go, you force the Holy, Holy, Holy Spirit of a holy God to go with you. Whatever that place may be. I don't have to worry about where I go. I'm born again. I'm washed in the blood. That's right. You're washed in the blood, and you are a vessel that contains the Spirit of a holy God. And maybe you might maybe consider some of the places you force that Holy Spirit to go into. Maybe you might consider some of the conversations that you force the Holy Spirit of God to be a party to have to listen to. Maybe you might consider some of the actions that you do in the performance of your daily life. And you are directly involving the Spirit of a holy God because it lives within you. Is there remission of sin afterward? Of course there is. Does it happen often? Yes, it does. If we would just soberly and calmly sit down and consider the things that we do, the things that we typically say, the places that we typically go and don't even think anything about it, and consider the fact that we are dragging the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost of a holy God. We are forcing that Spirit to be a party to the things that we do. That thought should be as sobering as the thought of having to look your sacrificial animal in the eye, the animal that you own, and look that physical living animal in the eye and put your hands on that animal's head and tell that animal, you must die so that I can live. Because there has to be some bloodshed, there has to be some death involved in the ability for me to commit sins. For my pleasure, you have to die, because that's what Jesus did. He died so that we could experience the pleasure of our sins. The Bible says that there's pleasure in sin for a season. Jesus had to die. Jesus had to be bled out. He had to be humiliated. He had to die so that we could experience that season of whoopee, however you want to refer to it, whatever you want to call it. Somebody has to carry the death and the repercussions and the consequences of the sins that we commit. Somebody has to do that. Otherwise, we die for our own sins. Our blood be upon ourselves. Our sin be upon our own head. We have to transfer that to something else. Something has to die so that I can live. That should be sobering to each and every one of us. The peace offering, in the sense of living in peace and harmony and unity with God as well as with our brethren. The peace offering does not bring peace between man and God. That's not what it's designed to do. But it represents the joy or the peace of living in His peace. John 16 and 33. Jesus says this, these things I have spoken unto you, that in me you might have peace. Jesus said, because of me, you're going to have peace. These things I have spoken unto you, so that in me you might have peace. That's fantastic. That sounds great. That's great. Let's just stop right there. Let's just stop right there where he says we can have peace, and let's not read any further. We can't do that. Because we are participating, brothers and sisters, in the entire, in the whole gospel. And the whole counsel of God, as Paul referred to it. And I have not refrained from teaching you the whole counsel of God. What was Paul saying? I've taught you everything. The good, the bad, the indifferent, the hard to hear, the not so hard to hear, the pleasant to hear. I've taught you the whole counsel of God, not just the stuff that I know you would like to hear. I don't want to drop my pen again. It's like a baby's pacifier. I will give you my peace. In the world, he says, listen to what he's saying. In the world, you shall have tribulation. In the world, you shall have tribulation. He did not say, maybe some of you might have a few rough days. It's not what he said. He did not say, some of you are going to get away clean. Some of you are not are going to have, your existence is going to be smooth as silk from day one to day end. It's not what he said. He said, in the world, you will have tribulation. Be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. He has overcome the world. Well, don't that mean just exactly what it says? Don't that mean that we have a peaceful, great existence because he has overcome the world? Yes, he has overcome the world, but are deformed babies still born every day? Do people still get in fights and shoot each other every day? Are people still serving prison sentences for crimes they've committed every day? Do people die of drug overdoses every day? Do bad things happen to just about everybody on the planet pretty much every day? Yes. Well, how can that be possible if Jesus has overcome the world? Jesus provided us a way out of the world in the end. He provided us a way that we can overcome the things in the world. Not that we can escape the things of the world. In another place, he said, I pray for these people that are in the world. I don't pray that you take them out of the world, but I pray that they'll be able to make it through the things in the world. We are not promised cotton candy lives, brothers and sisters. We are not promised peaceful existences in the terms of the word, the way we like to think about a peaceful existence. We're not promised that. We're promised just the opposite. Jesus said, I spoke these things unto you so you could have my peace. In the world, you will have tribulation. Will have. But be of good cheer because I've overcome the world. John 14, 27 sees this. Peace I leave with you, my peace. Read that properly. Peace I leave with you, comma. Pause. There's a pause there. A comma represents a pause. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Now, what does that mean by implication? There is a peace that the world has to offer. There is a peace that the world can offer you. Sinners enjoy peace all the time. I've always found it fascinating, and these things are in movies because it's the truth. But if you'll notice in a movie where there's a situation where like a serial killer or some evil person, when they're plotting and scheming, they're evil. If it's a serial killer, when they're plotting and scheming the way they're going to murder people, the way they're going to go about these things, what does it show them doing? It shows them sitting around in these plush, well-furnished environments. The lights are all down low, and in the background, there's classical music playing. That's the peace before the storm in a sinful, tumultuous life of turmoil. You're looking at a scene from the life of a serial killer where he's contemplating the joy and pleasure that he will enjoy in the death of another person, because that's what rocks his world. And in preparation for this, to get himself in the mood to get himself prepared for going out and doing this, he's sitting in this very nicely lit room with classical music playing in the background. That's his peace. There is a peace that the world has to offer you, but the peace that Jesus promised us is not that peace. Let that sink in. Think about that. Consider the fact that Jesus said, you can have peace, but it's not like the peace in the world. That should be red flag. That should shoot up an alarm and say, wait a minute, this is something I need to consider. This is something I need to ponder. This is something I need to study. This is something I need to understand. Jesus promised me peace, but he told me it wasn't the kind of peace I'm going to be expecting, and he told me that all in the same breath. So this is a place where I need to pay some attention and dig in and see what's going on. Because he has told me that he has promised me peace, and without batting an eye, he said, but it's not like the peace that the world can offer you. So that should tell me that there is a peace that the world can offer me. But it's not good. It's not good enough. It's not the kind of peace that the body of Christ needs to enjoy. Only he can offer that kind of peace. So this lets us know this is a place in the Word where we need to dig in. We need to dig in and try to understand what he's saying. Peace I leave with you, John 14:27. My peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Don't let your heart be troubled, and don't let it be afraid. That's not a tagline that Jesus left in the Bible so Sean Hannity would have a way to end his show every night. That's not the purpose of that being in there. He's trying to show us something. He's trying to teach us something. He's trying to lead us down a path. He's saying, there is a peace that I have to offer you, and it's quite different from the peace that the world has to offer you. Because the world can offer you more than turmoil and tumultuous daily lives. It can offer you a peace. It can offer you a fake, man-made resemblance to a peace that is void. It's vanity. It's non-existent. But human beings desire it so much that they're willing to accept that in place of the real peace that Jesus has to offer us, because we don't like the things that go along with the peace that Jesus offers us. Case in point, John 15, verses 18 and 19 says, if the world hate you, pay attention to what Jesus is saying here. If the world hate you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world, listen to what he's saying here. If you were of the world, he's just assuming that you're not part of the world. He's just assuming that you've listened to what he said. He's assuming that you have absorbed the teachings and the doctrine that he has worked himself frazzled trying to get us to understand. He's assuming a lot of things here. If you were of the world would love his own. If you are a member of the world, brothers and sisters, the world will love you. The Bible says, woe unto you when all men speak well of you. Do you think God just hates us and he just don't want us to be happy and he don't want us to have any good feelings? He don't want us to have any self-confidence. He don't want us to feel good about ourselves. He don't want us to feel like we can accomplish things. Do you think that's what God thinks? Do you think that's how this is? God realizes that the world is an enemy to you. He realizes that the God of this world, Satan, not God, not Jesus, the God of this world, who clearly Jesus said was Satan, hates you. There is nothing about the existence in the world and the worldly people that love you unless you are part of them. They hate you. And they hate me. And they hate you and me because of what we supposedly represent. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego stood up. They stayed on their feet in the presence of everybody on the face of earth that counted at the time. In their presence, they stood up. They did not bow down and say, "Now, God, you know that we don't worship this image that Nebuchadnezzar is up here. And you know that we worship you, but we're not going to be able to be any good to anybody if we get killed. And you know that if we don't bow down in the presence of everybody here, then they're going to take our life. And then there's going to be nobody left to stand up for you," which is in fact not what we're doing right now. That's not what they did. That's what the church, the modern day church, is doing. "I'm not going to be able to do anybody any good unless they feel comfortable being around me. So therefore, I have got to put on the clothes and the attire and the attitude and the political stance of the world so that I can befriend the world and do some good in the world." That's what the church is doing. The church is Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, bent down, bowed down in the presence of the image, whispering under their breath to God and saying, "You know we worship you. We don't really worship this image. But if they kill us, then we can't do you any good." That's what the church is. The church is a bowed down Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Yeah, we're worshiping God, but we're looking just as much like the world because we want to be able to talk to the world. We can't have a conversation with them people if we don't act and look and think like they do. Can we, God? Can we? Jesus said they hate you. But if you're of them, then they will love you. Isn't it funny how you got it right? And we're so wrong. We are so wrong in the way we think about this, and it's written down for us, but we don't consider that we should listen to what Jesus said way back when. We know better than he does. We know what it takes to fill a building full of people. We know what we have to do to get the world to come in so that they can hear this gospel that we're trying to shed, the love of Jesus and the love of God and the ATM validity of the prosperity gospel and God is a big Santa Claus sitting on by his reindeer up in the heavens and he's just got gifts and presents to throw down to the earth to everybody that'll mention the name God. We know better. We've redefined, we've reshaped, we've rewritten the Bible, we've reformed the gospel, we've changed everything about the gospel so that the world don't hate us anymore because we just don't like to be hated. We just want to fit in. We just want to be part of the crowd, don't we? If the world hates you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love his own. But because you are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hateth you. Why is the words of Jesus not good enough for us? Why is it that we think we're better than the words of Christ? Why is it that we think that we found a better way to do things in this modern day times than Jesus knew about back then? Why was he not forward thinking enough to understand the modern day society and the plight that we have in the church to continue on and to be able to be a presence in the world? Why he don't understand what we have to do? We've changed the gospel. We've changed the Bible. We've rewritten the words of God. We've rewritten his thinking, his thought patterns, and his thought process. And we put ourselves in a position to where the world don't hate us anymore. The world does not hate the mega church. The world does not hate these things because they're part of the world. The world hates you. And the world hates me. And the world hates you and me because of what we represent, if we represent the truth and the gospel. If the world does not hate you, if you do not find yourself in a position where you are in opposition with everybody who is not saved, then you, my friend, are doing something wrong, not them. They're doing their job. The world hating you, and the world opposing you, and the world persecuting you, and the world coming after you and condemning you and calling you names and making fun of you and mocking and scoffing you, they're doing their job. They are doing to you exactly what Jesus Christ himself promised you and I they would do. And instead of accepting that and trotting on and overcoming on a personal level, we change the way we think, and we change the way we dress, and we change the way we act, and we change the way we read the Bible so that we can fit in more in the name of, I'm just trying to strike a chord for Jesus. Acts chapter 14, verse 21 and 22 says, "And when they had preached the gospel to that city and had taught many, they returned again to Lystra and to Iconium and Antioch, confirming the souls of the disciples." So in other words, he's describing what Paul and his company had done. They preached the word in all these cities, and then they returned back through the cities where they already been preaching the gospel, confirming the souls, or making sure they had continued in the gospel they had taught them, confirming the souls of the disciples and exhorting them to continue in the faith. Don't back down, don't change, don't lessen your effect, don't back away. He wanted to make sure they were continuing in the faith. And listen to this, this is the most important part of this, and that we must, through much tribulation, enter into the kingdom of God. Now, why didn't Paul say, if you just listen to what I'm saying, if these prosperity preachers are right, if they're correct in their doctrine, if they are correct in what they're saying, then why did Paul never say, if you listen to my words and continue in the faith and continue in the doctrine that I have taught you, you will have it made. Everything is coming up roses. Not another problem in the world. No, that's not what Paul ever said. Ever. We must, through much tribulation, enter into the kingdom of God. 2 Timothy, again, Paul, our apostle, the apostle to the Gentiles, our apostle, the apostle to the body of Christ. 2 Timothy 3, starting in verse 10. "But thou," talking to Timothy, "hast fully known my doctrine, manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, charity or love, patience, persecutions, afflictions, which came unto me at Antioch, at Iconium, at Lystra." What persecutions I endured. Paul didn't lay out what a wonderful life he was having. Paul didn't lay out how he was getting a brand new car with a brand new chauffeur every 6 months. Paul didn't lay out how he had moved out of a 10-bedroom house into an 18-bedroom house in the name of Jesus. Paul didn't lay out how he was wearing Rolex watches and diamonds on his fingers. If the prosperity gospel is correct, why did Paul never teach the prosperity gospel? Why did Paul never teach the doctrine of the rich? Why did Paul never teach those things? Because it's fake and it's false and it's anti-biblical and it is... It's unbelievable that people still fall for it. It's unbelievable that it's still going on. "But out of them all, the Lord delivered me." Why? Because he provided us a way to have peace in the midst of these storms. And it wasn't through cushy comforters and warm fuzzy blankets and big shiny houses. "Yea, and all that will live," listen to this, "all," not some, not most, not a portion, not a remnant, "all that live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution." All that live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. You can read yourself that scripture 10 times a day and it'll never be enough. All that live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. But evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse. The world around you is going to get worse and worse and worse. These men who seduce you, these men who with cunning words pull you into their snares like pretty little dressed up spiders, they will get worse and worse, Paul says. Deceiving and being deceived. They have to be deceived before they can start deceiving you. They have to be convinced of a truth. These men that teach these doctrines, these prosperity doctrines, they are fully on board with this. They're not showmen. They're not like Steve Martin in that movie Leap of Faith. They're not putting on a show. You got to understand that. They absolutely believe the words they are speaking. They're not showmen. They're not carnival barkers. They're not actors in a movie. They literally believe what they're saying because they were deceived first. And they have built an entire world around them based on the deception that they fell prey to begin with, and began to teach it to you, building this giant Ponzi scheme of Christianity. Because that's exactly what it is. The man on TV dressed in a nice suit trying to lure you into buying lottery tickets is the exact same spirit that's on the other channel dressed in a nice suit trying to get you to send him $10 so you can get the $1,000 in the mail from somewhere else. It's the exact same thing. It's gambling. But the difference is, the guy selling you a lottery ticket works for a living. The guy trying to sell you the doctrine of Christ for money believes what he is saying because he was first deceived. They will get worse and worse, Paul says, deceiving and being deceived. But continue. This is what Paul says. This is how this is fixed. This is how we go about overcoming this. This is your out. This is your way out. This is your escape valve. But continue in the things which you have learned, in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them, and that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. That's your escape valve. That's your exit strategy. That's your way out of the mess. And it's not a way out of the mess. It's a way to overcome the mess and keep from being spotted by the mess. It's not dragging you out of the stinky garbage pile. It teaches you how to keep the stinky garbage pile away from you, just far enough away from you to keep from becoming stinky yourself. He didn't promise us to take us out of the garbage heap. He promised to give us a way that would not allow the garbage heap to overcome us. That's what he promised. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8 through 11 says, "Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, your enemy, the one who hates you, the one who is determined that you die, the one who is determined for you to go." See, Satan don't mind it if you die and go on to heaven. Satan cares not for the ones who are already in the holding pattern. Heaven, those people are out of his reach. He don't care about those. He cares about the ones who are still on the planet Earth, who are still alive, and who are still capable of exposing him for the evil killer that he is. Those are the ones he worries about. Satan don't cry when a saint dies and goes to heaven. Satan rejoices because there's one gone from the face of the earth. Don't think for a minute that when you die and go to heaven, Satan's going to sit down and cry or be joyful or anything. He cares that you're off of the face of the earth because you have the potential to expose him for the evilness that he is. Once your body's dead and you're in heaven, that potential's gone as far as he's concerned. Therefore, he is your enemy. Therefore, he is the one who seeks your destruction. He is not your friend, my friend. He is not a cohort. He is not a companion. He is not someone that you should sidle up to and try to get along with. He hates you. He's your enemy, and he wants you dead. Period. End of story. He wants you dead. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about, seeking whom he may devour. Whom resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions, listen to this, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. But the God of all grace, who hath called us unto his eternal glory, not our temporary glory here on the face of the earth. He's called us unto his eternal glory. When does that start? When we die. When does God's eternal glory for us begin? When our temporary existence as mortals on this earth comes to an end. Not while we're here. We're not supposed to glory and bask in the wonderfulness that is the planet Earth while we're here. Our eternal glory in God begins at the point we leave this earth, either in death or rapture, and not a minute sooner. Not 1 second before that will that begin. The God of all grace, who hath called us unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after you have suffered a while, make you perfect, establish, strengthen, settle you. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. After that ye have suffered a while, make you perfect. When are you going to become perfect? When we move into our heavenly existence. That's when we're going to become perfect. When we take on that eternal existence, when we shed this mortality, when we shed this corruptness, when we shed this evil that we're bound by right now, because this flesh is evil. This flesh that we are forced to live in causes us to do everything wrong and to do nothing right. Your flesh will never lead you down the road of the correct choice, ever. It will never do. It is incapable of that. It is incapable of leading us down the correct road. We are at constant daily war with the very flesh that we live in. That's a hard thing to understand. That's a hard thing to wrap your mind around. We are in constant turmoil with the very tabernacle that we cannot escape, except at the point of death. We can't come out of this. You can talk about out-of-body experiences all you want to. You cannot escape the flesh, the carnality of what you are until you die. That's when we will be made perfect. That's what he's saying here. So after everyone has suffered a while, so now we have to define what a while is. Well, you have to understand that what he's talking about is that you have suffered until the day you die. That makes you perfect. But the point I'm trying to make here is that we are guaranteed, we are promised. Listen, these are promises. These are promises that God and Jesus have made to us. Promises. We're going to suffer. We're going to have tribulations. We're going to have trials. Now, am I just trying to knock everybody down and tell everybody that you know, life ain't worth living and there's nothing good? That's not the point I'm trying to make. Again, we have to let the Holy Ghost lead us in the balance of what these things are. Because that's ultimately where the understanding comes from. I can't teach this stuff. I'm not trying to teach you anything. I'm trying my best to learn. I'm trying my best to get by day in and day out. I'm trying my best to refine myself and to change what I can. I'm trying my best to listen to the voice of the Holy Ghost that lives within me and stop me from doing these things and to bolster me into doing the things that I need to be doing. Because I'm living in a human flesh. I'm living in a body that is diametrically opposed to everything about the gospel, just like we all are. Nobody can teach you how to do this stuff. But until we realize that these things are absolute facts, then we can never come to the place where we can allow ourselves to let the Holy Ghost of God lead us and direct us, because It's not like he just turns us loose and you know, and I read a post on Facebook yesterday that it just made my jaw drop. God don't care about elections. God's not involved in the things that go on in the world. God could care less about who's in charge of what country and what nation's at war with what. And it went on and on and on. And this is from a Christian now. This is from a man who's supposedly a preacher, teacher, whatever. And it just, I kept thinking to myself, that could not be more wrong. That could not be more wrong. The Holy Ghost living within us lets me know, if for no other reason, the fact that the Holy Ghost lives within me lets me know that He is concerned with what I do every single minute of every single hour of every single day of every single week that I live. He's concerned with all of those things. Why would somebody make the statement that God does not care about what goes on in the world when God gave everybody in the world access to His Spirit 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and the ability to go to the Spirit and ask for guidance and leadership? How can you possibly say, as a Christian, that God don't care about what goes on in the world? How can you possibly get to that conclusion? Do you see how the church, the body of Christ, is so lame, and it has so crippled its own self by these stupid, stupid doctrines of devils, Paul called them? We're looking at shiny things and we're leaving out the doctrine of the gospel. So no, I'm not trying to get you to feel bad about yourself. No, I'm not trying to convince you that God's people won't enjoy things on this earth. That is not what it's about. What I am trying to say is that God's people are promised to be able to enjoy things on this earth in a completely, totally opposite way of what the modern popularist church wants you to believe. That is what I'm trying to say. Don't try to convince me that God's not concerned with the things that goes on in the world when He gives a little bit of Himself to every single human being that's alive that will accept it. That's just not the case. The peace offering described here as preceding the sin offering, for a reason we'll get to later on, is the last in order of the sacrifices when they're all presented together. First, the whole or the burnt offering taught the need of and symbolically wrought propitiation and atonement for sins. Next, the burnt offering represented the absolute surrender of man's will to God's will. The meat or the grain offering, by its gift of homage, declared the loyal submission of the offerer, and then followed the peace offering, symbolizing the joy which pervades the souls of those who are in communion with God. Peace offerings were distinct from burnt and sin offerings. In the latter, sin and atonement for the sin were the chief things that were being symbolized. In peace offerings, fellowship with God, which is the result of atonement and forgiveness of sin was the chief point. Portions of the peace offering were to be eaten by the offerer. When I brought my peace offering, it was cut up. Some of it was given to the altar to be wholly burnt. Some of it was given to the priest to enjoy. And some of it was given back to me. And I could take it back to my tent and share it with whoever, family and friends. So the portions of the peace offering were to be eaten by the offerer, me, signifying the enjoyment of restored fellowship with God. They were really thank offerings because the offerer was thankful to be at peace with God because of the remission of his sin. The essential characteristic of the peace offering was the feast upon the sacrifice, participated in symbolically by God by means of the part consumed on the altar, and by the part that were eaten by his ministers, and actually by the offerer and his companions. It serves as a memorial to the Israelites of the institution of the covenant between God and themselves, and reminded them of the blessings that they enjoyed. Now remember, it reminded them of the blessings in God, but remember where they are. They're taken away from a life that they've always known. They're taken out of Egypt, which they begged to go back just for a couple of watermelons and a cucumber. It planted them squarely in the middle of a desert situation where there's no water, there's no rain, there's no firewood, and there's no food, and there's no way to grow food. And they got to be reminded of the blessings of God. Well, from their standpoint, just like in today's society, I know a lot of people that stand around and say, "What's God done for me? I'm poor. My car's broke down. I got 3 bald tires. I ain't got a job. My refrigerator's empty. And my wife's in the bedroom crying her eyes out because we've got such a wretched marriage. What's God done for me lately?" It's easy to look around and see things like that. It's easy for them to look around and say, "You know, my whole life is sand and sandstorms, and what little bit of meat I've got is through the livestock that I can barely keep alive." What did they have to look around and rejoice over? These peace offerings reminded them that in the midst of all of their situation, they were still at peace with God. There was still peace with God to be gotten. It don't matter what situation we're in, there is a peace of Jesus that is not the peace of the world that he offers, that can be gotten and had nowhere but in Christ Jesus. That's the point of the peace offering. Verse 2, "And he shall lay his hand," again, here we go with the looking the animal in the eye, "he shall lay his hand upon the head of the offering and kill it at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. And Aaron's sons shall sprinkle the blood upon the altar round about." As always, our sin is placed upon the head of the sacrifice. Something has to die so that I can enjoy my sin. Jesus had to die so that Kent Wiggins could enjoy the sinful times of his life. Otherwise, I wouldn't have got any enjoyment out of it. I got to play. Jesus had to pay. I got to play. Jesus had to play. Had to pay. I didn't have to pay. I didn't die for my sins. I didn't die for the things I was doing in my youth that I had no business doing. I didn't die for the places that I went in my wasted youth where I had no business being. I didn't die for the things that I ingested into my body. I didn't die for the things that I did with other people. The harm, the hurt that I put on other people, the harm, the murder that I committed with my mouth and the hatred of my brethren. I didn't die for any of those. Jesus had to die so I could do those things. Where does that put me now? Now that I understand, in the same place that she put us all, now I understand what I was doing wrong then. And I accept that I was doing wrong, and I accept the fact that Jesus had to die. He had to pay with his own blood and his own breath and his own life. He had to come. God had to put on this same flesh that I wear and come down here to the earth and be made fun of and kicked around and hung on a cross and died so that I could get away with the things that I was going to get away with starting in 1961. And see, now that has a humbling effect on me personally. And that humbling, that understanding, that deep desire to never allow things like that to happen again is what I'm trying my best to convey. But ultimately, I can't do that. Ultimately, we all have to allow the Holy Ghost to lead us down this road. Conviction, the replacement of a stony heart with a heart of flesh, all those things, those are all works that the Holy Ghost has to do. Nobody can do them for us. But it all begins right here. It'll never happen if we don't subject ourselves to the whole counsel of God. Genesis chapter 3, this all goes back a ways. Genesis chapter 3, verses 17 and 18. And unto Adam he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife, and hast eaten of the tree of which I commanded thee, saying, thou shalt not eat of it, cursed is the ground for thy sake. In sorrow shalt thou eat of it all the days of your life. Thorns, very important here, thorns and thistles shall it bring forth to thee, and thou shalt eat the herb of the field. Something has to replace the sin that we enjoy. Something has to die so that we can enjoy the pleasures, however short-term they are, of sin. John 19 and 2 says, and the soldiers platted a crown of thorns, and they put it on his head, and they put on him a purple robe. 2 Corinthians 5 and 21, for he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. The sin of me has to be placed on the head of something else for that sin to be expunged and to be redeemed and to be called back. Jesus is the one that did that, the suffering servant, which is described in Isaiah 53, starting in verse 4. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes we are healed. Let me go back and read that in a different way. And it might do you some good also if you'll go back and read it in a different way. When you're by yourself and you're all alone and you're pondering and you're understanding these things, maybe for the first time, you're understanding the gravity, the hugeness of what he actually did for you and for me. Starting in verse 4 again, surely Jesus has borne Kent Wiggins' griefs and carried Kent Wiggins' sorrows. Yet Kent Wiggins did esteem or see him stricken and smitten of God and afflicted. Finally, I did. But Jesus was wounded for Kent Wiggins' transgressions. Jesus was bruised for Kent Wiggins' iniquities. The chastisement of Kent Wiggins' peace was upon the back of Jesus Christ. And with Jesus Christ's stripes, Kent Wiggins was healed. Kent Wiggins, like a sheep, has gone astray. Kent Wiggins has turned every single time to his own way. And Jesus hath, and God hath laid on Jesus the iniquity of Kent Wiggins. Jesus was oppressed and Jesus was afflicted, yet Jesus opened not his mouth. Not one time did Jesus ever say, I refuse to do this because Kent Wiggins is going to be such a bad person. Never. He did not open his mouth. Jesus is brought as a lamb to the slaughter. He's brought as a peace offering to the slaughter. He's brought as a sacrifice to the slaughter. He's brought as a sin offering to the slaughter. He's brought as an offering for iniquity, just like a lamb. And as a sheep before her shears is dumb or silent, so Jesus opened not his mouth. Jesus bore Kent Wiggins' sin so that Kent Wiggins did not have to pay for his own sin. He offered us his peace. His peace he offers us. Not the peace of the world. His peace. The peace that only he can offer. And I want to talk a minute about the crown of thorns. A lot of people never considered the crown of thorns. Several things to take into consideration. After Jesus endured the fake trials and the brutal beatings by the Roman soldiers, and before he was crucified, the soldiers twisted together a crown of thorns and set it upon his head. And they put a staff in his right hand, and they knelt down and bowed in front of him and mocked him. Matthew 27:29 says, and when they had platted a crown of thorns, they put it upon his head and a reed in his right hand, and they bowed the knee before him and mocked him, saying, Hail, King of the Jews. A crown of thorns would be very painful, but it was more about the mockery than it was about the pain. Here was the King of the Jews. Take this into mind. Consider this. Let this sink in. Think on this a while. Here we have Jesus Christ, the King of the Jews, being beaten and spit upon and insulted by ordinary, common, everyday Roman soldiers. These weren't even leaders in the Roman army. They were common soldiers. Taking a symbol of royalty and majesty, which is a crown, and turning it into something painful and degrading, specifically for the purpose of mocking him. And what did we just read in Isaiah 53, the suffering servant? He didn't open his mouth. He didn't offer one word of rejection. He didn't say, don't do that. He didn't say, stop. He didn't say, I've had enough. Not one time. Just like the sheep that cannot speak out against what's happening to him, he did not speak out against it. For Christians, the crown of thorns is a reminder of two things. Number one, Jesus was and is indeed a king. He is our king. He is my king. I must be and will be and am a willful servant to the throne of Jesus Christ, the eternal throne of David, promised to his seed. I will be a willing servant of that throne and of him who sits on that throne, Jesus Christ, as my ruling and eternal king. He is a king. He is King Jesus. He is my king, period. He is indeed a king. One day the entire universe will bow down to him who is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Revelation 19:16 says, and this is him, remember in Revelation 19, he gets on his horse and he leads all his armies out of heaven and he's coming to earth to take over. He is coming to earth to sit down on the throne of his father David, which was promised to his mother by an archangel so many years ago, so many decades, so many centuries ago. And he hath on his vesture and on his thigh a name written. And in the Bible, it's all in capital letters, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. What the Roman soldiers meant as mockery was in fact a picture of the dual role that Christ came to fulfill. First, of the suffering servant, which is described in Isaiah 53. Like a lamb, he bowed his back to the beaters. He gave his face to the slappers and the mockers. He gave his beard to be plucked. He didn't say a word. He didn't open his mouth. That represented the suffering servant. He was the suffering servant. That work is done, by the way. That work is finished, by the way. He said on the cross, it is finished. That aspect of him is done and over and behind him. That's done. That's gone. It is finished. The suffering servant part is done. It's over with. And the second one is the conquering Messiah, or the King to come, which you read about in Revelation 19. Number two, Jesus was willing to endure the pain and the insults and the shame all on my account. He did that for me, brethren, and he did that for you, willingly, happily. He lived through that. Willingly, I lay my own life down. Nobody takes my life from me. I'll lay down my own life, and I'll pick it back up again for a purpose, for a reason, so that Kent Wiggins don't have to die. The crown of thorns and the suffering that went with it are long gone. That's gone. It happened. It was a reality. It happened. He hurt. It hurt him. It brought him pain. It brought him humility. It brought him shame. It brought him all those things it was intended to do. But it's gone. It's rotted. It's in some hole somewhere. It's dust. It's forever lost to history. It's done. It's over with. All the pain, all the suffering, all that's gone away. It's done. It's finished. It is a work that is over. The suffering servant is no more. No more. That's why I say that hippy-dippy tie-dyed version of Jesus that you love to worship, that don't exist. It's gone. That work is done. That facet of his life is over with and finished. It has been accomplished. He did the part, as far as that's concerned, he did what he was supposed to do, and he completely and 100% fulfilled the will of God concerning the suffering Messiah. That part's done. It is finished. Now the next part, the crown, the wreath, the reward, the victory, the king, the coming and future eternal king is on his way. The crown of thorns and the suffering that went with it are long gone, and Jesus has now received the crown of which he is worthy. Hebrews 2. Starting in verse 9 says this, "But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death. He was made that way so that he could suffer the death." Now, listen to what Paul is saying. "But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man. For it became him." What does that mean? It became him. It was fitting for him. It was the right thing for him to do. It was the necessary evil that he suffered and accomplished and finished. It became him for whom are all things, and by whom are all things, in bringing many sons, that's you and that's me, unto glory, to transform, to build, to create, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through sufferings. For both he that sanctifieth and they who are sanctified are all of one. We are all one flesh. For which cause he is not ashamed to call me brethren. And he is not ashamed to call you brethren. in spite of every evil, wicked, nasty thing that we have in the past and continue to do. The sanctification process ends on the day we die. Until we die, we will continue to, we will die daily, Paul says. I die daily. Paul was our ruler. He was our rule of thumb. He was our apostle. He was the guidepost that Jesus gave to the Gentiles to look to and pay attention to. He was the one who taught us how to be grafted in. He was the one who taught the Gentiles how to become part of the vine. Not operate outside the vine. He was the one that was picked by Jesus Christ to teach us how to become part of the vine. Not the other way around. The gospel transforms us mainly through sufferings and trials and tribulations and afflictions that we have to tolerate on this earth because we're not part of the game here. We're not part of this world. We're not of this world. We're moving through this world. He instructed us to be in the world. He instructed us to take part in the world's activities. He instructed us to make ourselves subject to the rulers and the laws of the world, including kings and princes, but to remain apart from the world. Not to show how we are friendly to the world, to remain apart from the world. What did James tell us? That pure, absolute, when you boil it all down, when you take everything away, when you get it right down to the nitty-gritty, if you want to boil the whole entire Bible down to a few words, what did James say those words were? What did he say pure religion is? To visit the fatherless and the widows, and to keep yourself unspotted from the world. Make sure you take care of everybody around you and don't let the world get a hold on you of any kind. That's when you boil the whole Bible down into one sentence. That's what James says pure religion is. To visit the fatherless and the widows and to remain unspotted from the world. Now, there's also a significance, a symbolic significance that is embodied in the crown of thorns itself. We've already read the scripture, but when Adam and Eve sinned, bringing evil and a curse upon the whole world, part of the curse upon humanity was this. We just read these scriptures. And unto Adam he said, because you have hearkened unto the voice of your wife, has eaten of the tree of which I commanded you, saying, thou shalt not eat of it. Cursed is the ground for thy sake. The activities that you participated in, Adam, has put a curse on the very dirt that you walk around on. The dirt where which you till to get your food. The dirt that everything that lives depends on, plant-wise. That dirt became cursed. Cursed is the ground because of you. In sorrow shalt thou eat of it all the days of thy life. Pay close attention. Thorns also and thistles shall it bring forth to thee, and thou shalt eat the herb of the field. In the sweat of thy face shalt thou eat bread, till thou return unto the ground, for out of it was thou taken. For dust thou art, and unto dust shalt thou return. Now there are some I don't know if it's unintentional or not. I listen to these things that some people teach, and I wonder where they get these things from. I don't know if it's willful intent, or I don't know how to describe where they get these doctrines from. But there's a lot of people out there that teach this, that if it wasn't for Adam, men wouldn't have to work for a living. That is so not true. That is so non-biblical. Before sin came, before Eve was created, when Adam was by himself, God specifically said in the Bible that he needed a man to dress the garden. Somebody, it was designed from the beginning that somebody, Adam, had to work the Garden of Eden to make sure it remained the way it should be. somebody was always going to till the ground. Adam was always going to raise his own vegetables. Adam was always going to be a gardener and keep livestock and be a farmer. There was never one single second in God's existence biblically where man was just going to lay around and eat apples all day. That work is not the curse that was put on mankind. The thorns and the thistles and the weeds and the having to fight the dirt. I'm not much of a farmer. I can't grow nothing. My grandpa could set out fence posts and they'd sprout leaves. That was just the way he was. He could raise anything. But see, as a man of the garden, as he was, it was part of who he was. I mean, the man was his garden. I've never known another human being that was so in tune with the vegetable life of the earth. I mean, it's unbelievable. And none of that, zero of that, made it through the bloodline into mine. I promise you, I can water a tomato plant and it will die. Guaranteed. It will die. That none of that got to me. But as much of a vegetable, as much of a gardener, as much of a man of the earth as Papa was, he fought every day. He did something. There was not a day went by that he didn't have to go into his garden and do something. Whether it was till out between the rows, take a hoe and cut down weeds in the corn rows. I've seen him spend all day long hoeing weeds down in a field of corn. He was forever and constantly fighting to keep his garden from being overrun and taken over by weeds and thorns and thistles and other stuff that got in there. You don't have to plant weeds. You don't have to cultivate them whatsoever. You don't have to take them as little seeds and talk to them and scatter them in your garden so that you'll have something to do on long sunny afternoons. No, he spent his entire life fighting to keep that garden clean and pure and pretty. He took pride in it, which meant he spent a lot of time fighting the curse of the earth. And he knew that. He understood that. He understood what he was doing. He never griped and complained about having to do it. It was just part of it. It was what had to be done. He couldn't just throw tomato seeds out there and just wait till it was time to pick the tomatoes. There was work involved in that. And there was always going to be work involved in doing that. But you wasn't going to have to fight. You wasn't going to have to fight the weeds and the briars. You wasn't going to have to fight the briar thickets. You wasn't going to have to fight against those things to get to harvest the fruit of your labor. There was always going to be labor. So the curse, a man having to get up every morning and go to work, is not the curse that came upon Adam. The other stuff, the weeds, the thorns, the thistles, that's what's embodied in the crown of thorns. That's the symbolism that's embodied, the curse in the fact that there was thorns to make a mockery of Jesus with a fake crown out of. That's the symbolism that there. The Roman soldiers unknowingly took an object of the curse and they fashioned it into a crown for the one who would deliver us from the curse. Think about that. The very ones who took those thorns, they didn't have any idea what they was doing. They just knew they was going to make fun. It was funny. It was a game to them. So they grabbed some thorns that were just, you know, for no other intention purpose, because it'd cause a little more bleeding. It'd cause a little more pain. It was better than wrapping putting a crown on that was made out of some smooth branch. They did it with thorns. They did it. They took the curse of the earth and they made him a mockery, shameful crown, and they put it on his head. And those were the very ones that he looked upon wearing that crown of thorns, hanging on the cross, bleeding out, fighting for every breath that he brought into his body. He looked down upon those very same ones that did that. And he said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." The very ones that mock him and spit in his face, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. So the Roman soldiers, they unknowingly took an object and of the curse, and they fashioned it into a crown for the one who would deliver us from the curse. Christ redeemed us. He redeemed me from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for me. Galatians 3 and 13 says, Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us, for it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree. Jesus, in his perfect atoning sacrifice, has delivered us from the curse of sin, of which a thorn is a symbol. While intended to be a mockery, the crown of thorns, in fact, was an excellent symbol of who Jesus is, which is the fulfillment, again, of the will of God the Father. Back in verse 2, and Aaron and his sons shall sprinkle the blood upon the altar round about. This speaks of the altar of sacrifice, which is outside the tent, as it appears in the situation. Remember, here's the tent, here's the outside curtain, here's the tent of meeting. This is where the sanctuary is and the Holy of Holies. Outside here is the laver of water where you washed. And this is the altar of sacrifice that it's speaking of. Now we're going to read about the northeast and the southwest corner, the opposing things. That would be here, the northeast and the southwest corner. Because remember, this always faced east. This door, this open door, this single door into the fence and into the tent itself, always faced due east. So these corners, these horns of the altar, these two, this northeast would be this corner and this corner. Now that's what it's talking about. The blood was drained from the animals into pots, and it was handed over to the priests. It was then sprinkled all around the altar. The rule in the Mishnah, which is the written version of what is known as the oral law, states this: the slaying of the burnt offering is in the north, or on the north side of the altar. And its blood ought to have two sprinklings, which answer to the four sides of the altar. It must be that the sprinklings would comprehend all four sides of the altar. And this is done when the two sprinklings are upon the two horns, which are diametrically opposite or opposed to each other. These two should include the four sides and the two opposite horns, which are the northeast and the southwest horns of the altar, so that the blood of the two sprinklings might be found upon the four sides of the altar, because it is said of the burnt offerings of the peace offerings round about. That's what the verse says. The blood shall upon the altar round about. Those are the words that are used. The rest of the blood was poured out at the bottom of the altar on the south side. This was always done by a priest, for when the bullock might be killed by anybody, the blood must be sprinkled by a priest. 1 Peter 1 and 2 says this: elect, according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, through sanctification of the Spirit, unto obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ, grace be unto you and peace be multiplied. That's a greeting. That's a greeting that Peter is making there to people that he's writing a letter to. Now keep that in mind. Keep that in your mind, that this is a greeting in the opening of a letter that Peter's writing. Listen to what he says. According to the foreknowledge of God the Father, through sanctification of the Spirit, the separation of you from the world of the Spirit, unto obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ, grace be unto you. In other words, I can't write any of these things I'm fixing to write except Jesus sprinkled his blood for us so that we might receive grace and his righteousness. Hebrews 12 and 24 says, and to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling that speaketh better things than that of Abel. Again, the sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ. There is power in the blood. Hebrews 10 and 19, having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest, in other words, to enter into the Holy of Holies, having boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus. He's talking about me and you. He's talking about the way that we can come to God just as I am, in boldness, or without worrying about dying for my effort. The way that happened is through the blood of Jesus Christ. Having therefore boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus. That's the only way we have access to Him. By a new and living way, which He hath consecrated for us through the veil, through the curtain that hung and separated the two rooms, through the veil, that is to say, His flesh. We've already mentioned it is finished when He spoke those words on the cross. It is finished. He gave up the ghost. And when He gave up the ghost, what happened? The veil in the temple split in two from top to bottom. And the mantle over the door of the entrance of the temple broke. Access was granted to every single human being alive at that point. Let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Jesus said, I wash you with the water of the Word. That's how we wash ourselves. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for He is faithful that promised. He did not make us any empty promises. He did not make us wrong, willfully wrong promises. The promises that He left us are the promises that still stand, and those promises were made possible by the sprinkling of His own blood. Jesus had to do every single thing that every increment of what we read about in the book of the law, in the book of Leviticus, every aspect of every one of these sacrifices and these bloodlettings and these deaths and these laying on of hands, every single aspect of these things, Jesus had to take that upon Himself. He had to perform every single solitary one of them. And they were all pertinent and they were all important and they were all vital. And we cannot have what we have today without they had what they had then. Because everything was a foreshadow and a pointing of and an indication of the Messiah that was to come, which turned out to be Christ Jesus, my King, who fulfilled each and every one of these things. Verse 3, and He shall offer of the sacrifice of the peace offering an offering made by fire unto the Lord. The fat that covereth the inwards, and all the fat that is upon the inwards, and the two kidneys, and the fat that is on them, which is by the flanks, and the caul, which is a thin membrane that surrounds the liver, the caul above the liver, with the kidneys, it shall He take away. In any burnt offering described in verses 1 through 17, the fat that is by the inwards, the fat that covers the inwards, the kidneys, the flanks, the caul, the liver, and the rump, all of these were considered the choicest or the first fruit cuts of meat from any of these animals. Therefore, these cuts were always placed upon the altar and completely consumed by the fire. They were God's portion. They were what returned to Him as a sweet smell, a sweet savor. They were completely consumed. In peace offerings, some of the meat was cooked upon the altar. Some of it was kept to be eaten by the priests. And some of it was cooked upon the altar and returned to the offer to be eaten by his family and shared with friends if he so desired. The first fruit cuts of meat were considered to belong to God and were to be completely burnt up. Verse 5, and Aaron's son shall burn it on the altar of the burnt sacrifice, which is upon the wood that is on the fire. It is an offering made by fire of a sweet savor unto the Lord. Verse 6, and if this offering for a sacrifice, a peace offering unto the Lord, be of the flock, in other words, if it's a sheep or a goat, again, male or female, he shall offer it without blemish. If he offer a lamb for his offering, then shall he offer it before the Lord. And he shall lay his hand upon the head of his offering. See what I'm saying here? We're reading over. We went over thoroughly the aspect of all these things in the beginning. Now we're just going to read through. We're just going to read because it goes through the cycle with each different kind of sacrifice. It goes through the cycle. So we're just going to read the words out loud. If he offer a lamb for his offering, verse 7, then shall he offer it before the Lord. Verse 8, he shall lay his hand upon the head of the offering and kill it before the tabernacle of the congregation. And Aaron's sons shall sprinkle the blood thereof on the ground and upon the altar. Verse 9, he shall offer of the sacrifice of the peace offering, an offering made by fire unto the Lord, the fat thereof, and the whole rump, or the whole back end. It shall he take off hard by the backbone, and the fat that covereth the inwards, and all the fat that is upon the inwards, and the two kidneys, and the fat that is upon them, which is by the flanks, and the caul above the liver, with the kidneys it shall he take away. And the priest shall burn it upon the altar. It is the food of the offering made by fire unto the Lord. Verse 12. And if his offering be a goat, then he shall offer it before the Lord, and he shall lay his hand upon the head of it and kill it before the tabernacle of the congregation, and the sons of Aaron shall sprinkle the blood thereof upon the altar round about. Again, we've already covered that. The horns, the circling of the altar, the sprinkling, the pouring out. Verse 14, and he shall offer thereof his offering, even an offering made by fire unto the Lord, the fat that covereth the inwards, and all the fat that is upon the inwards, and the two kidneys, and the fat that is upon them, which is by the flanks, and the caul above the liver with the kidneys, it shall he take away. Verse 16, and the priest shall burn them upon the altar. It is the food of the offering made by fire for a sweet savor. All the fat is the Lord's. It is to be totally consumed and totally burnt up. Verse 17, it shall be a perpetual statute for your generation throughout all your dwellings, that you eat neither fat nor blood. In other words, forever and ever and ever, no matter where you live upon this earth, you will never, ever, ever consume the fat or the blood. It will be a perpetual, forever, eternal statute or law or commandment for your generations throughout all your dwellings, no matter where you live, that you eat neither fat nor blood. There was a spiritual significance as well as a practical significance to this command. Number one, we enjoy peace with God by giving Him our best, which is represented by the fat. The best, it was considered the best parts of the animal. And we give, it symbolizes us giving Him the best that we have to offer. The Bible tells us that we should make our whole entire bodies a living sacrifice. And then it goes on to say, that is your reasonable service. What does that mean, that's your reasonable service? And in other words, it means that's the very least that you can do. The absolute very least that you can do is to make your very body a living sacrifice unto God. And remember our example of being a sacrifice. We do it without griping. We do it without cursing. We do it without mumbling and moaning about it. We keep our mouth shut. We do it willingly, and we do it often. We don't grumble and complain and desire to go back to Egypt for a cucumber and a half a watermelon. That's not how we make ourselves. What are you sacrificing when you do that? What are you sacrificing when the entire time you're offering some kind of sacrifice to God, you're complaining and you're griping and grumbling about how it's hurting you, how it's inconveniencing your life, how it's making you stop doing what you want to do and do something you're not comfortable with? What's the point in that sacrifice? That's wasted time. That's hardly considered sacrifice by God. He said, make your entire bodies a living sacrifice, and that's your reasonable service. That's the least that you can do. That's the least you can do. So we enjoy peace with God by offering Him our best. That's what we're supposed to be doing, which is represented by the fat, and to giving Him our lives, to being totally surrendered to the will of God. That's represented by the blood. The life of the animal is in the blood. The fat and the blood. We give Him the best, and we give Him our life. Even as it was impossible to remove all the blood from an animal, so it is impossible to remove all the fat from the meat. This speaks of removing as much as we possibly can. Again, just because I can't afford a Bentley don't mean I'm going to throw away my driver's license and quit driving cars. Because I cannot live up to the full, complete letter of the Bible and the will of God does not mean that I have to give up. It does not mean that I can be cozy and complacent with my existence by reading these things on Facebook that tell me that, well, I tried, but I'm not perfect, so I don't need to try no more. That's not what it's about. It's about trying and continuing to try in the face of everything to do your very, very best and to offer God the very best you have to offer and to never, ever, ever give up. That's your reasonable, so that's the least that you can do. Number two, you shall eat neither fat nor blood. The practical significance, of course, is the prohibition of eating fat was good for Israel from the standpoint of blood cholesterol and heart disease. So see, it was a double thing. God declared all these parts of the animal that were unfit for humans to consume or that was detrimental to human health. He declared them to be the best of all the animals and that they were His. Put all these things that are unhealthy for you to eat on the altar and let them be completely and totally burnt up. Let them become mine. There was obedience involved. There was giving up the best part of the animal involved. And there was also an advantage to their health, to their physical well-being involved in that. It was especially good because tapeworms and other parasites were often found in the fatty tissues. And by obeying this command, the ancient Israelites avoided all of these things. Hebrews chapter 9, starting in verse 8, says this, "The Holy Ghost, this signifying that the way into the holiest of all was not yet made manifest," or it was not yet made available to us. "While as the first tabernacle was yet standing," the first tabernacle, "while as the first tabernacle was yet standing, which was a figure for the time present, in which were offered both gifts and sacrifices that could not make him that did the service perfect as pertaining to the conscience, which stood only in meats and drinks and diverse washings and carnal ordinances imposed on them until the time of reformation." Just think about this. Think about from the time they finished the tabernacle and started the daily sacrifice until the temple was destroyed in 70 AD by the Romans. Think about how many millions and millions and billions and billions and billions of animals were killed in the name of sin, in the name of redemption. Billions upon billions and billions of animals died so that men could live sinful lives, so that men could go on unchanging and living their sinful ways. These animals, billions and billions of them died. Not one single solitary drop of the trillions of gallons of blood that were shed by animals in the name of sinful mankind, not one single drop of that blood ever, 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 ever took away one single sin. Ever. None of it ever took away a single solitary sin. It pushed it to the side. It covered it up. It obliterated it. It made it hard to see. It created a veil. It created a separation. It created all of those things, but it never, ever, ever took away one single solitary sin. Ever. But yet it was absolutely required. If you did not participate in the shedding of animal blood for your sins, you did die and go to hell. Because death are the wages of sin. If you did not participate in the bloodshedding and the killing and the slaughtering of these animals in the name of your sin, you died and went to hell. But at the same time, not one single drop of this blood ever took away one single sin from any one of those people who are in heaven right now that Jesus cleaned out of the bowels of the earth. because those are the people he went into the bowels of the earth to get. The ones who were in Abraham's bosom are the ones who died righteous deaths according to the law. They're the ones who killed the bull at the right time. They're the ones who brought the sheep to the priest. They are the ones who toted their sacrifice to the temple. They are the ones who participated in what was laid out by God to Moses. They are the ones that Jesus went and got and took to heaven. But nothing that they ever did on the face of this earth ever took away any sin that they committed. That's why Jesus went to them. That's why they went to them and he said, these are the things that you did to fulfill the law. And then he presented himself and he said, I am the fulfillment of the law. That's exactly what he did to us. He did the exact same thing to the face of the earth as he did to the ones in the bowels of the earth. And they had the option to either believe him and accept him as the coming Messiah or reject him, just like the people on the face of the earth did. They had the same exact option. So the ones who accepted him, he took to heaven with him. And the ones who rejected him, they stayed there. And Abraham's bosom became just another room in what is known as hell, Sheol. They were there for the rejection of Christ, just like the ones that went there yesterday. The ones that Jesus left behind after offering himself to them are in the same hell as the sinner who died yesterday with unrepented sin on his back. Same exact place, same exact fire, same exact flames, same exact hell that was created for the devil and his angels. Not one single drop of that blood ever did for them what the blood of Jesus did for us. Not one drop. That's why Paul continues with this. But Christ, being come and high priest of good things to come by a greater and a more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands. What tabernacle is he talking about? This tabernacle. That's what he's referring to. A much better tabernacle, not made with hands. He's talking about Jesus Christ in his glorified body after he has fulfilled the will of the Father and the law and the prophets and died and resurrected as promised. He resided in a tabernacle not made with hands. The tabernacle that died and that he left behind in the tomb when he went away, the tabernacle that was changed in the twinkling of an eye at his resurrection when he came back, that tabernacle was not made with hands. We're living in a tabernacle that is made with hands because we're born of the flesh and conceived through the consummation of a man and a woman. That's how we come about. We are a tabernacle made with hands. One day this tabernacle is going to take on an eternal body. That same tabernacle is one not made with hands. That tabernacle, that glorified body that we're going to take on, was not created by the coming together of a male and a female of a species. That body, that glorified body, was created by Jesus himself, a tabernacle not made with hands. So that's what he's talking about, Jesus becoming a high priest, doing a better service, a better work, in a better tabernacle, not made with hands. That is to say, not of this building. Neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood, he entered in once. Into the holy place and not this holy place. Not this one. Remember, the holy place that existed when Jesus walked the earth, the Ark of the Covenant, was never there. That temple stood for 450 years with no Ark of the Covenant inside of it. That was an empty room. There was nothing in the Holy of Holies in the second temple. The Ark was gone with the first one. It never came back. The temple that Jesus walked around the outside of, inside the Holy of Holies of it was empty. It was an empty room. By his own blood he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. For if the blood of bulls and goats and the ashes of a heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctify to the purifying of the flesh, if the blood of bulls and goats, which could never take away sin, could sanctify or set apart or make holy this flesh that is mortal and nasty and sinful, if that could do that, then how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, how much more will that blood purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God? These men that stood around these altars, these priests, these sons of Aaron, these men that stood around these altars and poured blood and chopped up cows and skinned meat, took the skins and hides off, that did all this work, all this manual labor, day in and day out, from the days of Moses right up to the days of the Roman army. Every single day, these men labored and labored and labored and did the same things over and over and over again. If that, as useless as it is, could obtain sanctification for those people in their mortal flesh, how much more perfect can the sprinkling and the shedding of a sinless Son of God, Jesus Christ, separate us from our sins? How much better does that have to be? We should recognize that on a daily basis. That, my friends, is chapter 3 of Leviticus. I have no idea how long this lasted, but we covered one whole chapter in one sitting. I hope that you stuck with it to the end. I hope that I'm not boring you. I hope that everyone is learning like I'm learning. I hope that you're getting closer to Jesus and your walk is becoming more and more clear, and the understanding that Jesus is on his way and he is coming soon. I've used this analogy before for years. I've used this, I don't know how many times I've said it here, but in my mind, when I envision what's going on in heaven right now, in my mind, this is what I see. I see God the Father sitting on his throne, and I see his Son, Jesus, standing up. And I see God the Father has got him by his coattails. He's hanging on to him by the back of his robe, and Jesus is doing his dead level best to get away from God the Father and to go get his children. And he is begging the Father, let me go, let me go, let me go. That's what I see going on in heaven. We are that close, brothers and sisters. We are on the verge of the greatest thing that will happen to the face of the earth since the day it was molded together by the hands of God. When our Savior, when our Lord, when my King comes stepping out of the air and he comes through the clouds and he sounds a trumpet and all the dead in Christ shall rise and those who are alive and remain shall be caught up in the air to be joined with him forever and ever. We are literally minutes away from that happening. Minutes away. It's never been more clear in American and in human history. It's never been more clear that we are on the verge of the end of all things. And actually, it's not. It's the beginning of all things. We're on the verge of the beginning of eternity. I see it. I hope you see it. I hope if you don't, you pray to see it. I hope you're enjoying these studies. I hope that God is blessing you richly out of it. Pray for me and I'll pray for you. And as always, until next time, God bless you greatly. Thank you for tuning in. Thank you for joining me on this journey.